Good evening. Hello. I think there are quite a lot of you here today already. There are 42 of you. Good evening to Nicola and Heather and Tina and Laura and Mickey and Hey Tigers and Busted and Iznikia and Angela and Jill and Ingrid and Asini. And there we are. I will say good evening to you all. And I hope you've had a wonderful Sunday, and that your weekend has been enjoyable. I've been lucky to enjoy the wonderful weather and had a delightful barbecue in my little courtyard, which was very pleasant. Just a simple feast with salads and burgers and venison and lovely things like that. So it was absolutely delightful. So thank you to you all. Well, there's plenty to talk about today, so I don't know where we begin. Daniel hopes it was vegan friendly. I'm not vegan, but I don't mind people who are vegan, that is a personal choice, so I don't foist that upon other people. There is no problem with people who are vegan or vegetarian. People who like fish or people who like meat, but as long as the animals are well treated, I don't have a problem with that. But that is something that I think may divide some of this audience, so I think we will move on from that. Lucky is a recovering vegan. Well, there we are. Flower Garden has venison regularly. Louise loves chickpeas and claims everybody else does. Well, everybody likes different. I don't really have favorites of anything, Mike, but I do like parsnip soup very much. I love Baxter's soup, as the lady, Ina Baxter, was once said of, the Scottish lady, and I did encounter her factory on occasions, and her lovely personality. She said, I was born to make soup, and she was, I think, Baxter's soup, are particularly good, fine examples of a commercial soup making operation, but I do like homemade soup. Paulie likes lobster soup. Well, a lobster bisque can be quite delicious, yes. There we go. So I think I'll begin with the Crooked House this evening. Some of the other topics, I've already made a list which I did put out there. Kevin Spacey, Prince Harry and his Invictus Games, Boris Johnson being loved in Ukraine, and a Mail Online poll about the Duke of York's daughters, which follows on from the Mail Online poll from yesterday about Prince Andrew. So I hope that gives a good variety. And here we go. So today, this morning, this afternoon between 5 and 5:40, there was a program on Radio 4 called The Crooked House, presented by Adrian Goldberg for File on 4. It was a bit of an update, and Mr. Goldberg lives in the vicinity of the Crooked House, at the edge of Dudley. So for those of you who don't know, the Crooked House was built in 1765. It was originally a farmhouse, and then it became a pub because the community changed from a farming area primarily to being a mining area. And the mining caused subsidence to the building, which is why it was tilted. It suffered from subsidence. And it tilted 4 foot from one end to the other. So it became known as a pub, first called the Glynn Arms, and secondly called the Crooked House, which was obviously more appropriate to it in that situation. Hello, pub. Sadly, the pub, Let's Go, is no more. They described it as being like something from an Alice in Wonderland film. So on the 5th of August, well, in the summer, the pub was sold by Marston's Brewery, who said it was no longer commercially viable. The former landlord did explain something quite interesting in that the pub is 1 mile down a lane, a country lane, which lots of people dump rubbish on. And he said, you know, this was all very off-putting to people, but once you got there, you got into the mystery of the Alice in Wonderland nature of this pub, and people came to love it. So the pub was put up for sale. I believe it was for £675,000 at an auction, and I did actually see this thing listed, and I was interested in it, just as a story, but I never did anything with it, which was a shame, because what happened next was terrible. So the pub was sold to a couple, Mr. and Mrs. Taylor, through one of their various companies. They happened to own landfill sites, which happened, one of which I believe adjoins this pub. And then on the 5th of August, there was a fire at the pub, and the pub is derelict. It had been unoccupied for quite some time, and it burnt to the ground. Well, the shell remained. So the people who owned it sent in some kind of demolition crew on the 7th of August, and the whole building was destroyed. But the reason that this fire took hold was there were two mounds of earth placed 60 foot apart that blocked the firefighters getting near to the pub. So they had to take long distance water pipes rather than taking their machinery closer to the actual pub, which quite frankly was obviously somebody had planned this ahead. And very interestingly, the pub was not a listed building when it should have been. There was an intention to make it a listed building, but it hadn't happened yet, which all rather convenient that they managed to destroy it prior to this happening, because this changes the situation as to what could happen next. So this pub was acquired by these people, the Taylors, and their businesses. The local community were very upset by this. People started going there and leaving tributes and saying how disgraceful it was. And two men have been arrested on suspicion of arson. A third man was also arrested and bailed. All three have been bailed. So, you know, there is suspicion that this fire was arson. So it was not an accident. It was not an act of God. It was somebody intentionally destroying this thing. So then it seems that they put in a dog unit, which intimidated people, and they stopped people being there. There was a camp of people who were trying to protect this, what remained of this pub, because they want it rebuilt. Now, in London, in Maida Vale, there was a pub called the Carlton Tavern, and some other people who were not connected to these ones bought this pub, and they did not seek planning permission. They just knocked it down, and that was a listed building. They have been made to rebuild it brick by brick. These people need to be held to account. So it seems now that the site has been secured with a prohibition notice. So now nothing further can be done. There were people selling bricks allegedly from there on Facebook. 25,000 bricks have been salvaged, are now being stored on site with the protection of new people who are not connected to the people that destroyed it. They're not connected to the people who were immediately there in the vicinity. And this was all discussed on this program. I thought it was a very interesting program. You can go on to the BBC iPlayer and listen. It's called The Crooked House, File on 4, Radio 4, which I believe you can get Radio 4 all around the world. So if you're interested and you're abroad, I would suggest you could even get it that way. But it seems that this couple have previously had a number of other incidents involving buildings. They bought another pub, which was called the Sarah Mansfield. And that, surprisingly, has also been stopped being a pub, and they want to turn it into flats, and everything's been ripped out of it. And one of the people who met the presenter, Mr. Goldberg, actually took him into it to see what had been done, and the whole place had been ripped apart, and they wish to build 6 apartments there in a house. And I think it's a great shame. Pubs are part of communities, and you know, down here we have the lovely Magnet, which is it's the heart of the community, and people of all walks of life go there. And I think it's wonderful that they have everything from quiz evenings to music, and that they have a group of ladies who go and do their knitting there, and you know, people can join in. People can go there and have a cup of coffee, or they can have a pint of beer, or they can have a glass of wine, or whatever they choose. And people bring their dogs, and they all bring different things with them. Like one day, recently, a gentleman baked a cake, and another lady brings sausage rolls, wonderful sausage rolls, in fact. Some of them made with black pudding. And talking of which, this pub was situated on the edge of the black country, and the locals really felt it's got a huge significance to them. And they are some of them cried as they talked about it, and had, you know, their passion for this pub was indicative of the absolute, you know, shamefulness of what has been done to what should have been kept as a piece of heritage. Whether it remained as a pub or not, it should have been kept as a building for a start. But I think it would have been best kept as a pub because people clearly loved it, and people loved it all over the world. People have been making models of it. There's all sorts of things going on. But this lady, Carly Taylor, her husband, who they have several different companies, they put the phone down on the presenter the lady did, Adam Taylor, and they have businesses called AT Contracting and Platform Hire. They've had other fires at sites that they've been connected to in Oxfordshire, Buckinghamshire area. It seems very odd that this has gone on. So I do urge you to perhaps listen into that. So yes, it is very upsetting about the Crooked Pub. I totally agree with you, Busted. Yes, there we are. So that's, you don't like black pudding. Well, each to their own. I also like white pudding. I came across a lady who makes black pudding and white pudding in Northern Ireland, and I think she's doing very well with her business. Pennine County say it was black pudding throwing at Ramsbottom, Lancashire earlier today. Well, I didn't know about that, but there we go. There we are. So moving along, there was also something you might also enjoy, given many of you enjoy a quiz. I don't have anyone here with me at the moment, so I won't be doing a quiz today, but unless somebody appears. But I'm not anticipating they will. I'm by myself at the moment, so having had people with me for most of the day. This morning, between 12:04 p.m. and 12:32 on Radio 4, there was a wonderful thing called Paul Sinner's Perfect Pub Quiz. It's only less than half an hour. If you like quizzes, do tune in. I would suggest it's very good. They had questions about Rishi Sunak and who had the most overdue library book, for example, which turned out to be Walpole. It wasn't returned for 228 years to a college in Cambridge by one of his descendants. So there you go. That's a bit of a useless piece of information, but he's in the Guinness Book of Records for having kept a library book for far too long. And I think many people keep library books for far too long, and half of them probably disappear into the ether. But there we go. So I would say that if you like a quiz, then that was quite an enjoyable way into it. And I'd never heard of Mr. Sinha before today, but his perfect pub quiz was quite enjoyable. So there we are. So moving along, I could have said a lot more about the Crooked Pub, but we will save that for another day. the next topic. Well, this morning I did myself write about Kevin Spacey. Mr. Spacey was featured in the Mail because a rather eccentric man I'd never heard of called Jeffrey Mark decided to talk about him when he was arriving at an opening at the Hollywood Museum. And this friend of Mr. Spacey went on and on about the exonerated actor, because for those of you that don't know, and I'm sure most of you do, Mr. Spacey was accused of many offences, allegations of offences, and he has been exonerated of them. There were 15 allegations from 15 different people. Only a few of them went to trial, but most of they were dismissed recently in July. Now, Mr. Mark has announced that Spacey is planning a big comeback. Well, my personal knowledge of Mr. Spacey, I do not know of his situation with his court cases, of the people involved in that, but I do know people who've worked with him, and they don't have good things to say about him. And I personally find his friendships with the likes of Prince Andrew, Jeffrey Epstein, Ghislaine Maxwell, and Harvey Weinstein telling. Not a good choices to have as friends. Busted says Spacey is an arrogant person. Well, that is the experience that I have from people I know who have worked with him. And, you know, they've worked with him, big names themselves, and they have been, they didn't like him. Absolutely appalling. But Mr. Mark said, you know, that he was thrilled to discuss this on camera about his friend. He's one of the most talented human beings on the planet, and he needs to get his career back because we're missing out on all the wonderful, wonderful performances he's still got left in him. So let's leave all this nonsense behind. Well, it wasn't nonsense to the people that made those allegations, and you know, and it wasn't nonsense to Mr. Spacey. So, and it wasn't nonsense to the court system, and you know, he has been exonerated in this instance, but he himself admitted to, you know, having had strange ways of behaving, and he did apologize for things he couldn't remember in one instance. I personally don't wish to see Kevin Spacey return, but many people probably do. He said, let's celebrate Kevin. He's my buddy. I do. Kevin's a brilliant conversationalist. And yes, he does like younger men. Men. Yes, there have been times he's shown up with a blonde or a brunette on his shoulders. But they were grown folks who were intelligent, brilliant conversationalists. Kevin has given so much to charity that people don't even know about. That's the guy I know, this charity-loving, charity-giving, bon vivant raconteur who is more talented and more attractive than even he realizes. And I just feel blessed. I just feel blessed. It's so good to be a little part of his life. And then he talks about the allegations and was he fairly treated. You know, he said he thinks it all happened too quickly. I think it happened too much. But I don't think it's unfair because there are folks out there who are guilty of these things. Kevin wasn't guilty, so therefore nobody else is, as no, unfortunately, a lot of people are, he added, just not him. And sometimes we have to err on the side of the children and say, well, I take it on the chin because you've got to keep these kids' welfare as the most important thing. I think if the scandal were about anything else, I would say he was terribly and unfairly treated. Only because the subject was children, you've got to take a stand and say, this is unfair, but in a way it's understandable. I'm thrilled that he's been exonerated. That's fair. As for his return, he basically calls for Kevin Spacey. What next? He's lost so much. He's going to have to rebuild. But he concludes, I won't read it all out because it could go on forever. He's going to do something new and creative because that's who Kevin is. And we're going to see a whole new creative side there. And I'm gonna, he keeps saying gonna, not going, to say that, of course, that most things are gonna say, wow, I never knew. There's a lot more coming. There's a lot more coming, and I'm thrilled to see it. Now, I just think that Mr. Spacey is a man of poor judgment. The photograph I used was him sat in Buckingham Palace on a royal throne, which is very inappropriate behavior, with Ghislaine Maxwell to his side on another throne. Mr. Spacey has associated with Epstein, with Mandelson, Peter Mandelson, Elton John, Naomi Campbell, the temper tantrum prone model, the temper tantrum prone Elton John, as I've mentioned, the alleged sex pest, Prince Andrew, the alleged war criminal, Sir Tony Blair, the convicted sex offender, Harvey Weinstein. Now, honestly, I think Mr. Spacey is a man of very poor judgment, and I don't celebrate his return. I am not particularly interested in seeing any more of it. I don't know how you feel. Press, put number one if you would like to see Mr. Spacey return and celebrate it. Or number two, if you feel that Mr. Spacey deserves to be sent on his way and forgotten about and pensioned off. Be interesting to see. Most of the reaction here is that you're not fans of his and you don't really wish to see him back. But we have had two ones. There we are. He was scheduled to be in a film about the Getty family, and of course he was replaced in that by Christopher Plummer, who did a far better job in my view. There we go. I've seen that film and I quite enjoyed it. That was an interesting thing. So, yes, Mr. Spacey is supposedly going to be the comeback king. I think that it is an unfortunate state of affairs that he is trying to do this. I would say perhaps it would be better if he just went away quietly, because I don't see the need for him to return. But, you know, if people want him, money will talk and the studios will hire him, as this man, Jeffrey Mark, pointed out. But I think that the plan to revive him doesn't have appeal to me, but there we are. So next, Boris Johnson. Now, Boris has turned up in Ukraine. He was given an honorary doctorate by the Ivan Franko National University. He becomes a doctor honoris causat. And he was met by cheering fans who serenaded him. He's a cult figure in that country. He was mobbed. He shouted to the fans, "Glory to Ukraine." And he already holds the Order of Liberty from President Zelensky. He's got a Hollywood Walk of Fame style flagstone in the capital. He's an honorary citizen of Kiev, or Kiev, depending on whether your pronunciation is one way or the other. The Ukrainians prefer the former. And he's also an honorary citizen of the port of Odessa. Now, isn't this a contrast to how people thought of him in Oxfordshire? You know, the people of Brightwell come Supwell, where he's just bought the £4 million Brightwell Manor. They have gone around putting up EU flags because they just don't want him in their area. Now, when he was living in Knightsbridge, the people I knew who, when he borrowed the home of Lord and Lady Bamford for a while, I don't know if he's still using it, but he probably is, knowing him. He caused havoc in the neighborhood. People were not impressed by his presence. There were security guards and all the rest, and it's a nuisance to any neighborhood to have the likes of Boris Johnson or Prince Harry and Meghan in your neighborhood, because you get drones coming over your house, you get You get stalkers, you get busybodies, you get photographers. And these people in these wealthy areas where the likes of them live don't like it. And the people I knew who had to have Boris Johnson as a neighbour in Knightsbridge were not impressed. And it seems the people of Brightwell, come Sutwell in Oxfordshire, are equally unimpressed. He also wants to dig out a swimming pool, and the locals have objected, and the local authorities have objected, because there are supposedly newts in the vicinity, because it is a moated manor house. So I suppose it's got various ponds and lakes and a moat around it that's semi-derelict, I believe. But, you know, he is upsetting the locals already, and no doubt his security guards running around when he goes off running irritate them also. And would you really want the wine-chucking carry as your neighbour equally? I would not. But quite right, Melissa, protect the wildlife. Why does he need a swimming pool? Why doesn't he go to the local swimming pool and patronise that? Although I'm sure there's a hotel in the vicinity with a swimming pool, he could probably sign up and become a member. But it's up to him what he does with his money. But I don't think he should be interfering with the poor old newts. Leave the newts alone, Boris. You've caused enough trouble for humans. I'm not a fan of Boris. You know, the lady I did the program with the other day, June, who has proven very popular and deservedly so, she loves Boris, but we differ on that topic. But that's the way of the world, isn't it? If we all thought the same, the world would be dull. So that is where we're up to on that. Now, I move along to the next topic, which the Mail Online. We talked yesterday about Prince Andrew and a poll, which was that the majority of Britons felt that they wanted him sent on his merry way, effectively. The latest poll today, which they shared, was about his daughters. Now, 57% of a poll conducted by Delta Poll, they interviewed 2009 British adults between the 1st and the 4th of September, felt that they should be removed from the line of succession. They do have jobs, so they have their own private income, they have trusts, and they have inheritances that they've been given. They don't really serve a purpose. They are not senior royals. I don't think that they should be there. Now, equally in this poll, 61% thought the Duke of Sussex should be removed from the line of succession, while 70% think that the former Kate Middleton, now Princess of Wales, should be queen. Now, why pick on the daughters? Well, why do we need the daughters, Davina? What use do they serve to our public? They don't do much other than wear silly hats, and they don't seem to contribute much. I don't see much evidence of Princesses Eugenie and Beatrice doing much. Their wayward mother is another piece of tow rag, and I'm sick of hearing about her and her devotion to the late Queen's corgis, and her stupid podcasts about tea, and her silly jokes that she makes, and her money grabbing. I would like to ask Fergie yet again the same question I will always ask the Duchess of York. Did you ever repay the loans and other benefits that you took from Jeffrey Epstein after he'd been into prison for sexual offences against young people? Did you ever repay that money? And your previous comment has been no comment. I say the word comment is superfluous, and you ought to tell us the truth. I think it is time that Fergie, away with the fairies, as Nikki calls her, is quite rightly questioned about that topic. That is the topic that she ought to answer. Her husband needs to explain why he paid £12 million to a woman he claims never to have met. And going on Emily Maitlis's interview programme, he was not set up, as Lady Victoria Harvey said. He was not forced into that interview with a gun. It was not about the lighting. He made the fool of himself. He could have controlled the questioning better. He could have got up and walked out. He didn't have to. He didn't have to do that. I'm very sorry to say my hay fever is starting to kick in, but anyway, never mind. I think it's because I've sat outside all day. And lots of people have sent me suggestions about local honey and all the rest of it. I've tried everything, and hay fever, I wish somebody could find a cure. Gin and the odd glass of red wine tend to help, but there we go. There we are. So gin is good for hay fever. Yes, Hello Magazine did share a survey, a piece of research about that once. Now, I know most people would say Hello Magazine is not a reliable source of information, but it was taken from some health study, and it was one of the top 10 things that they suggested. Yes, Vaseline under my nose does tend to help, but I did not think about doing that before I started this, because I was feeling okay until now, but I should have probably closed all the windows hours ago. There we are. So, yes, so that is that topic. Boris Johnson, we've done. So next, on to another member of the royal family, Prince Harry and his Invictus Games. He was told by the Mail, don't give up the day job, because he didn't do very well. He failed to score a single point in the football news version of the match of the day. He was beaten by the country's 63-year-old defence minister and forced to wear a local club scarf as a forfeit. Now, that was quite something. I'm just going to get a tissue to give me one moment. I do apologise for the interruption, but when hay fever strikes, it strikes, and I'm afraid I've struck. Please excuse me. I will continue. Yes, he flew to Germany by a private helicopter. Now, my question there is, who paid for the helicopter? He likes to go around in Elton John's private jets. He seems to be very good at getting other people to pay for his transport. Now, who paid for this? Did he pay for this, or was it paid for by someone else? That would be interesting to know. He was all smiles as he was told that he had to wear a German jersey, but he ended up with a scarf because they couldn't find one. So the whole thing is a bit chaotic. Doesn't seem to be very well run. He missed everything. I don't really think that this is a great start to his tour of this Invictus Games event. Singer Rita Orr will perform. She seems to go wherever they ask. You know, it's a football flop is what it was rightly called. I have to say, it's totally unnecessary of him to be doing all of this. I don't think it's helping him improve his image. I don't think he reads the room correctly. And he might be all smiles, but I think that most people would rather not see him. There was a lady called Madeline Durant who drove 2 hours from her home in Dortmund to see Harry. She stood there with a poster that said, "Harry, I came all the way to take a photo with you." I don't know whether she actually got her photograph, but there we are. Doesn't say. But this Invictus Games did seem like a jolly good idea at the start, but I don't really think it's part of the future narrative that will work. There we are. So, yes, wasted petrol. I think the aviation fuel, but Yes, I would say it's all a waste of... Why couldn't he just go on a normal plane like anyone else? Or take a train? I'm sure Greta Thunberg might have something to say about that, but who knows what she's got to say, but I'm not encouraging her. I don't know what you think about Greta Thunberg, but I will take some of your questions now. I think that's probably the easiest thing to do next. So we've covered all these topics, and we've done it very quickly in 35 minutes, but there you go. But I won't be able to stay for too long because I think that I will annoy you with my my sneezing. So there we are. Tomorrow I will not be making a video because I'm attending a funeral in London, and I think I will not be back until much later in the evening. So unfortunately, I will not be with you tomorrow. Some of you may be glad. There we are. So yes, do you have any questions? Oh, June has come in. Now, June did a wonderful job on Thursday, and everybody enjoyed June. There were many compliments, and it was an absolutely lovely afternoon, and we had a wonderful hour-long chat about all manner of topics, and we will be doing another chat, hopefully, in the coming days, and it will be lovely to do another chat with June. Bax Alexis. Now, the lovely Alexis is a wonderful lady, a good, very good friend of mine, and I believe Baxter Soup is still partly owned by the Baxter family, but I could be wrong. I haven't checked for now, but Baxter Soup is based near Inverness, and they make wonderful soups, and they do have a royal warrant. Well, they did used to anyway. I don't know whether it's still valid, but I would imagine it is. Hey Tigers likes Fergie. Now, are there others amongst you who like Fergie? If you like Fergie, put a number one. If you don't like Fergie, number two. But June, yes, and Alexis, welcome, and thank you for coming to join in. It's wonderful to have all of you here, and there are 393 of you live, and 90 of you have even pressed like. I'm glad you watched The Remains of the Day, and do I recommend the book? Yes, the book is an excellent book, and Kazuro Ishiguro is a fantastic writer. And as I previously said, for a man who didn't have knowledge of Britain prior to writing that, because he's from Japan, he did an absolutely wonderful, wonderful analysis of the British upper class society of that era, I think. It was quite brilliant, really. But I do think that the book is always, I always love to read a book. You know, another great film, The Talented Mr. Ripley, which I believe they are remaking. Now, I'm not so sure about remakes of films, but the book, and High Lorne, Patricia Highsmith was a fascinating woman, a very vicious woman. She was a lesbian lady who lived in France, and she carried snails around in her handbag. I don't know why. It was a very strange thing to do, but people do strange things. She was very vicious to all her partners. I did watch quite an interesting documentary about her. I can't remember what channel it was on, but it was not that long ago. If you can find it, look up the program about Patricia Highsmith. She really was a vicious, nasty woman, but many of these authors can be, you know, the children's authors, many of them don't like children, for example. You say it would be better than a ferret. Well, some people love ferrets. Ferrets are wonderful creatures. I used to want a ferret as a child, which I never got. I got everything to go with the ferret, but I was never allowed the ferret, and I used to get quite upset about it. I had every book about ferrets you could imagine. And ferrets, I will tell you, are not vicious creatures. People say they bite and they smell. Well, they only smell if people don't look after them properly. You know, that's like anything. If you don't look after it, it goes bad. Now, equally, if they bite you, all you need to do is play dead. Put your hand on the floor. If you wave your hand around, they'll bite you more. It's like any animal. So ferrets are wonderful creatures, and I think more people should be pro the ferret. Great creatures, and I've the people I know who've had them love and adore them. Most people think of Last of the Summer Wine with the character Compo, and that was quite a show, though I prefer Keeping Up Appearances with Hyacinth Buckets, you know, Patricia Routledge. Wendy says ferrets are ugly. Well, many humans are ugly, but we put up with them, don't we? You pick up the snails when it's raining. Oh, gosh. Well, don't put them near anyone's plants because they're not very good for plants, but there we are. Angela is afraid of cats. You always thought they were vicious, says Julie. Well, Davinia hunts with ferrets and thinks it's great fun. Now, that's going to be controversial amongst this. Whereas Porson Dawson wants to put a ferret on a harness. Now, well, I've seen people walking around with ferrets and as pets, parading them around. I've seen people walking around with cats, which is all on leads. And, you know, people do some strange things. But to know cats is to love them. There we are. Angela loves her dogs. My grandfather, says Caroline, kept ferrets. I used to handle them daily, never bitten once. Precisely. Ferrets don't bite you. Here is an urban, you know, one of these silly urban myths that ferrets are vicious. Why would I not buy myself a ferret? Well, I don't think it would be fair for me to be buying creatures because of any form, because I go out quite a lot and I do go around, and, you know, animals deserve to have full-time care and company. You know, I as a single person, I don't think it's correct to have an animal dependent on you when you have to go and do other things, and you can't take an animal everywhere, but most animals are better behaved than people, so there we are. Animals deserve a lot of love. I wouldn't have a ferret in a cashmere little jacket. No, the ferret deserves to be able to experience the joys of life in the wild and the things that it enjoys doing, which I think many of you won't want to hear about, so I won't tell you about what they like to do. But that's simply nature. I would not put a ferret in a cashmere jacket. I think people who buy Gucci saddles for their horses and things like that are just silly. You know, the animals can be, as long as you treat the animal correctly, and people who mistreat animals, especially dogs and horses, and the things I've seen pictures in recent days of a man who starved a dog, and he did get a jail sentence, but he should have got a far stiffer one. People who have animals and don't feed them, leave them in rotting in mud, you know, very, very bad. There we go. The weather in Broadstairs has been glorious, but with it comes the pollen, so hence why I'm being affected. Shooting a tiger under the dining table, I don't think that goes on very often. I think that used to happen in India occasionally, but I don't think that happens very often. There we go. They're a deeply unpleasant creature. I don't know who that was, but I think we're talking about a person. Well, Pebble Dasher, a total wrong'un. We're maybe talking about Fergie, I guess, but I don't know. These comments come in at a very different speed, to, I believe, to how you see them. So, unfortunately, sometimes when you do this quiz, some of you get there first, when on my screen you don't. So unfortunately, we have to go by my screen. Animal bites are dangerous. Well, they could be. Is there a cocktail? I like lots of different cocktails. Now, a very good book, which I will recommend, is Patrick Hamilton. I haven't got the copy here because it's upstairs, but you've just made me think of this, the cocktail, because this book includes a cocktail. It's called a gin and French. It's simply gin and vermouth. And then there's a gin and it, which is a gin and red vermouth. And this book is called Hangover Square, and it's based on a group of wayward people who live around Earl's Court just after the Second World War. And they're all constantly drunk and they're all having affairs. And it's written in a very strange fashion, but it's hard work to get into. But I thoroughly recommend Hangover Square by Patrick Hamilton. And whilst you're reading it, make sure you have a gin and French. It was a drink that was popular in that era, but it's not something that's well known now. But it's a very simple drink to make, and it's one you can enjoy. I do like a good Negroni. I like a martini. I think the best place to drink martinis in Britain is Duke's Hotel. It has a wonderful bar run by Italians mostly, and they bring a trolley and they bring a huge block of ice and they make it in front of you. And it is an absolutely glorious place hidden away in St. James's. I may even go there tomorrow because I'm going to be in the vicinity. I'm going to the funeral in Mayfair and then there's a reception afterwards nearer there. So, oh dear, I could be in for danger. There could be trouble ahead. But they do limit how many you can have because they are very, very strong. And I, at home, have wonderful ice grenades. I got these from America. They're simply plastic things that you fill with water. They look like a grenade. You put it in the freezer, and then you have one block of ice, and it fits perfectly into a good picnic-style glass that is the glass I prefer to drink from. I'm not really into all these balloon glasses with gin. But the concept of having one block of ice is very clever because small ice cubes melt quickly and then your drink is watered down. And who wants a watered down drink? That is the suggestion. Don't spill a martini on Joan Collins. Well, I don't intend to spill a martini on Joan Collins, but I don't know. I somehow doubt she will be there tomorrow, but it doesn't defeat the realms of possibility, but who knows? Linda says Patrick Hamilton is an amazing storyteller, yes. And he was also great at sharing the story with me of the gin and French, which was a drink I immediately converted many a bartender to because they hadn't heard of it. A lot of younger bartenders don't know of these old drinks. And I think the old classics are probably the best drinks out there. When I'm not drinking gin, I often just have a famous grouse with a little bit of water. I'm quite simple in my tastes. A lot of bartenders don't like making the drink the old fashioned because you have to stir it 16 times. Now, if you've got a bar full of people, that takes a lot of effort and you're holding up other drinkers getting their drink. So I think that's perhaps a bit selfish as a drink, but I would recommend a gin and French, a martini or a Negroni if you're going, or a simple gin and tonic. But to make a gin and tonic, you need a large block of ice, as I say, a picnic tumbler style glass, as I call it, which I always have chilled. All glasses should be chilled. You want to start off with the right temperature for your drink. And I would put a quarter measure of gin in the tumbler and, a third measure of gin and 2/3 of tonic. That's the simplest way to make it. Sometimes I might go a little bit beyond a third, but who knows? It depends what mood you're in. There we go. You like a proper champagne cocktail, says Davina. They can be nice on occasions. In the south of France, I tend to have a drink made with a drink called Chatenay. It's a liqueur made with walnuts, and you add a little bit of that to your champagne, and you get a delicious drink to have in the sunshine. And I drink that in a place called Le Garde Freinet, and they make it wonderfully there, and they grow the walnuts up there themselves, I think. That's a drink to be recommended. You're currently enjoying a rum and tonic. Well, that's a very nice drink if that's what you fancy, or a Brandy Alexander or a Pimm's. You got Guinness in a wine glass last week in an Italian restaurant. Well, there you are. That's how they think they serve it there. You're currently enjoying a number three gin and tonic. Well, that's a wonderful gin, as we've talked about gin before. Aperol. Yes, the Aperol Spritz is a very popular cocktail, but it's not my cocktail of choice. There we are. Your friend is Jamaican, Angela, and he thinks rum should be drunk neat. Well, that's his choice. Do I like gin mare? Yes, gin mare is quite a lovely, refreshing Spanish gin. Yes, quite enjoyable. Not my everyday gin of choice, but wouldn't say no. You've sent me some mini cheddars to the Magnet. Oh, well, they do sell mini cheddars there, so they might not want me eating them there. That might be a bit of a problem for them. There we are. You need a steeplechaser cocktail. Well, the Magnet really is more of a beer establishment, but they do sell wine and they do sell spirits, but they have been known occasionally to make a Bloody Mary, but they don't sell tomato juice normally, so that was a rare occasion. There we are. Four Pillars Gin. I think I have tried it, but I'm not. It's not one that's stuck in my mind. Have I had Moosehead beer? No. Do I like Clamato with beer? I can't say I've had Clamato with beer. I've had Clamato in Bloody Marys, but they were talking about that in that program about Kensington and Chelsea, which I talked about the other day. It's one of the best-selling products is Clamato at Partridges of Sloane Square, which is a grocer to the royal household. You don't think I'm much of a beer man? Well, I don't mind a lager. There we are. Scampi fries. Scampi and fries. I don't know how that comes into it. I don't think it's a cocktail, Angela, but to eat that, it's not a bad thing to eat if you fancy that. Yes. Oh. Do I like Wicked? No, I don't. I think that smells dreadful. And also Red Bull. I don't drink Red Bull. The smell of it is, I've never even tasted it. It smells so bad. And the stories you read about it. I did know somebody who was made a lot of money out of Red Bull. And another who made a lot of money out of a product that is available that's rather similar. But I don't like the idea of those drinks, and I don't like the smell, and I don't think I'd enjoy the taste. So not for me. But each to their own. If you like Red Bull, Red Bull does good for people with heart disease. I'm not sure if it does or not, but... I think it probably does not do you much good at all, to be honest. But you tried a violet gin. Oh, there's always Pimm's. Pimm's is nice occasionally. Not my go-to drink, but occasionally, why not? I have had one or two Pimm's in my time, but I think it's a shame that they don't have all the different varieties they used to have. There used to be many different... Pimm's cups, but they don't have them anymore. They've sort of moved along with that. So Joan Old likes an espresso martini. I don't like coffee, so I don't drink coffee, so I don't drink espresso martinis myself. And I don't really like cream liqueurs like Bailey's. I used to be involved in another cream liqueur called Vermeer. With the man who was in Sky Vodka, and it was made with vodka rather than whiskey, and it was rather good. It was a chocolate based liqueur, and it was rather good over ice cream, but I wouldn't choose to drink that every day of the week. No, it depends on what people enjoy. If we all liked the same thing, it would be a terrible place and the world would be dull and we wouldn't have all these variety of things. You're a Yorkshire tea drinker, says Angelo. I love Yorkshire tea. I always have a huge box of it. And if I travel, I take Yorkshire tea with me because I find local teas in many places are very poor abroad, particularly America. Americans make many wonderful things, but they're not very good at tea. They will say we're not very good at food, but we are having differences of a view on that also. What wine do I like best? Well, my go-to wine would be a Chablis or a Picpoul or something like that. You know, that's my sort of favoured wine. White wine, I like a Chianti very much. Depends really on the occasion. What did Margaret Thatcher enjoy? Well, Margaret liked to drink whiskey, and Dennis loved to drink gin. That was their drinks of choice. And they both enjoyed their drinks. Good, positive people. Our current prime minister doesn't drink. Don't know why, but he's not supporting the booze industry. And, you know, he hasn't done much with his stupid rises in duty, which annoys drinkers like me. So he's not much use to me in that regard. There we are. Well, you really like Nightimber. I know the people who make Nightimber. And they've done awfully well with their business. They've certainly spread the word of their wines that are made in East Sussex. There are plenty of vineyards down here. Some lovely ladies, South Africans, family, three sisters, I think, and their parents. They have a vineyard here called Turlingham. I've tried their gin, which is made with the Bacchus leftover grape, and it's a lovely gin made in a limited edition. Do look up the Turlingham Distillery, and you can also go and visit and try their wines. I've yet to go, and I wish to, and I should. If somebody comes to visit with a car, we'll go. I could do a visit there, and there's also a wine train you can go on down here. I'd like to do that. I think that could be quite fun. You know, there's always something fun to do. Especially in the world of alcohol. I've known many people in the alcohol business because I was in the alcohol business for over 10 years. And you do meet an array of characters and an array of stories. And one day I'll tell you the stories of some of the other people of the drinks industry I've met and some of the more eccentric ones. But I will save that for another evening. And at this point I'm going to say... Scruff gin. Well, that's the gin that they had in the Archers. I don't think that's done very well. They don't seem to talk about that anymore. That was obviously not a real gin, so you couldn't try Scruff gin. Goodness knows what it would taste of. There we are. Well, I'm going to say good night to you all. Thank you ever so much for your patience, and I do apologize for my sneezing and nose. It is annoying to have hay fever, and I hope the rest of you aren't suffering with it, and I hope that you all have a wonderful week, and I shall be back to talk to you further on Tuesday, and I wish you a wonderful, happy time till then, and I say good night to you all, and good gardening, and a very happy evening. Thank you ever so much. Night-night, pip-pip.